Di oleh kita. Ayo.
Pag mayroong nagtao dito,
wala pa na. Sige.
Pag may tao dyan na tumingin, ibig sabihin na kita kanila. Pero pag ilang oras ka na hindi nagsasalita na wala.
What are you? Mayroon na isa. Wala.
Yan na.
Paano lakasan ng ano, mami? Sounds.
Yung sounds mo? Lakasan mo yung sounds mo doon.
Saan dito?
Hindi, dyan. Nagsalita ka. Hindi mo naman yan sila maririnig eh. Ikaw, lakasan mo para marinig ka nila. Viewer lang yan sila. Wala yan sound. Magsalita ka lang.
Ah, sige. Sige, Ro.
Ang comment nila, makikita mo lang dyan.
Sige, okay, okay. Nakita ka mo. Okay, good evening, future compañeros, compañeras, no? It is already 6:02, no? And that I said that exactly 6 o'clock we will start my lecture, no? So for those who are taking the bar examination, no? There are 24 examination universities campus, no? Wherein the Supreme Court allowed to have a regionalized bar examination no longer in Manila. No? I mean to say that if you are in Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao or outside Metro Manila, you can take the bar examination because it is already regionalized. No? So my lecture today is on remedial law, but I will focus on trial Rule 30. Also, pre-trial, that is Rule 18, and the rules on evidence from Rule 132. As well as the 2019 rules on civil procedure. As I've said that the rules on civil procedure of 1987 was amended by the 2019 rules on civil procedure. No? But Rule 1 up to Rule 5 was were not amended, no? The amendments was only Rule 6 up to Rule 35, no? So Rule 36 up to the last rules were not amended, no? Because the civil procedure is Rule 1 up to Rule 71, because Rule 72 is up to Rule 109 is already special proceedings. Then 110, Rule 110 up to Rule 119 is the rules on criminal procedure, and Rule 320 is the rules on evidence. Anyway, as I've said that the rules of the civil procedure was amended from Rule 6, no? What is rule 6? Pleadings, no? Pleadings, no? If you file your complaint, then there'll be a responsive pleading. We call it answer. Then there'll be a reply. Reply is an answer to the answer. Then rejoinder. Although I will discuss later on third party complaint, fourth party complaint, and so on and so forth, and counterclaims. No? I will discuss it extensively in the next hours, no? Because I have 3 hours. No? So in rule 33, 34, and 35, those are the rules on demurrer to evidence. Now rule 33 is demurrer to evidence. Rule 34 is a judgment on the pleadings, and rule 34 is a summary judgment. No? So what are the significant amendments under the 2019 rules of civil procedure? You cannot appeal, nor you can file a petition for prohibition, mandamus, and certiorari, no? So if there is a, if you file a demurrer to evidence, denied, you cannot appeal, you cannot file a certiorari, nor a prohibition, nor no mandamus. Same with rule 34, no? Judgment on the pleadings, no? And rule 35, the summary judgment, no? You cannot appeal, you cannot file a certiorari, prohibition, mandamus, that because those are the significant amendments in the rules. Anyway, I will now proceed with rule 30, that's the trial, no? Then rule 18, pre-trial, then we'll proceed with the rule 132, that is the rules on civil, the rules on evidence. No? So, what is trial? So, if in the bar examination, the examiner will ask you, what is trial? So, you define trial as defined under the Valentine's Law Dictionary, second edition, page 1299. Trial is an examination before a competent tribunal of the facts or law put to issue in a case for the purpose of determining an issue. So if it will be asked in the bar examination, because it was always asked in the bar examination, if the examiner will ask what is a trial, trial is an examination before a competent tribunal of the facts or law to the issue in the case for the purpose of determining the issue. Then, in an old case, in the case of Director of Lands versus Archbishop of Manila, 41 Philippines, 120, it was asked in the bar, what is the justification for the law providing for an order of trial? So you cite the case of Director of Lands versus Archbishop of Manila, 41 Philippines, 120. In this case, the Supreme Court ruled that it is designed for orderly procedure which must be followed if injurious surprises and annoying delays in the administration of justice are to be avoided. Evidence should not be piecemeal. So remember the case of Director of Lands versus Archbishop, no? The Supreme Court ruled it is designed for an orderly procedure, no? In order that there is no surprises, annoying delays, and that evidence should not be piecemeal. No. Then another questions asked in the bar. No, give the order of trial in civil actions as provided for under the rules of court. No, it was asked in the bar examination. So if it will be asked, what will be your answer? So if there are several defendants, then so this is the procedure. No? The plaintiff shall adduce evidence in support of his or her complaint. No, so if this is the order of trial, in I will discuss later on order of trial in criminal cases. We focus first order of trial on civil cases. No, rule 30 of the rules of court. The plaintiff shall adduce evidence in support of his or her complaint. And that the complainant, the plaintiff, have only 90 calendar days or 3 months to present his or her evidence. So remember, no? Under the new rules of civil procedure 2019, that plaintiffs, the complainant, can adduce his or her evidence in support of his or her complaint only for 90 calendar days. Because under the new rules on civil procedure, there is now a rules on continuous trial. So that is rule 30 of the 2019 rules of civil procedure. So this is the case. Now, if all the issues are enjoined, then the judge or the court will set the case for preliminary conference. Now, so after the termination of the preliminary conference and that the court will issue an order, then the case within 30 days will be set for the presentation of the plaintiff's evidence. Under the 2019 rules on civil procedure, the plaintiffs or the complainant shall adduce evidence in support of his or her complaint within 3 months or 90 calendar days. Then, after the presentation, after the formal offer ruled by the court, and after complainant will say, complainant will now rest his or her case. Now, after the lawyer say that, Your Honor, the complainant is now resting his or her case, then the court will set the case for the defendants to adduce evidence in support of his defense, counterclaim, or close claim and third party complaint. No, same period under the 2019 rules of civil procedure. No, the defendants have only 3 months or 90, remember now, 90 calendar days, not working days, 90 calendar days. That includes judicial dispute resolution, alternative dispute resolution, same. No, the defendants will be given 90 calendar days or 3 months to adjust his or her evidence in support of his her defense, counterclaim, cross claim, and third party complaint. If there are a third party defendant, then the third party defendant will also given same period, no, 3 months or 90 calendar days. No, the third party defendant, if there is any, shall adduce evidence in support of his or her defense, counterclaim or cross-claim, and third-party complaint, 90 calendar. Remember, future compañeros, compañeras, 90 calendar days or 3 months. Then if there are fourth-party complainant, so on and so forth, then the fourth-party complainant will also adduce evidence in support of his or her complaint, same period, 3 months or 90 calendar days. No, so how about rebuttal evidence? Is rebuttal evidence allowed under the new rules on civil procedure, the 2019 rules of civil procedure? The answer is yes. No, the answer is yes. Parties can present rebuttal, not only rebuttal, no, but also sore rebuttal evidence. But after the defendants presented his or her evidence, then the complainant can say to the court, Your Honor, I move that I will present a rebuttal evidence. Can the judge grant that? Yes, the answer is yes. No, but with a limited period, only 90 calendar days, no? Only 30. Remember, compañeros, compañeros, only 30 calendar days. No, after the presentation of the rebuttal evidence, rested his or case, can the defendant ask for a sore rebuttal evidence? The answer is yes. No, the defendant, Your Honor, I will also the defendant will also present sore rebuttal evidence. Now, how many days? Same, 30 calendar days. Now, 30 calendar days. Now, so, after the parties presented their evidence, now, as directed by the court, now, then the case will be submitted for decision. So under the new rules on civil procedure, under the 1987 rules of civil procedure, parties will be given 30 days to submit their memorandum. So what is a memorandum? Now, a memorandum is the last pleading filed by the parties. Now, and that the memorandum will aid the court in deciding the case. Now, meaning to say that if you become a lawyer, now, once you become a lawyer, do not waive your right to submit your memoranda. Why? Because memorandum are the last pleadings and it will help the judge in deciding the case. So, in my case, once I receive a memorandum, both parties, if there are so many parties, then I will just compare the memorandum. Then I will choose from what memorandum I will decide the case. No, there are so many cases that I could not decide. No, very intricate. No, the issues are very very difficult to decide. No, so while I'm driving the car, I always once I stop in the stoplight, I always try my best what will be my decision. So I know that will be my decision. So remember, under the 2019 rules on civil procedure, parties also given time to submit or present their respective memoranda, because memorandum are last pleadings and it will help a lot the court in deciding the cases. So, you know, I've been an MTC judge for 7 years and 16 years as an RTC, the judge, no? That the cases in MTC are more easier than in RTC, no? In RTC, that is very, very complicated, no? Especially there is a certiorari, provision, mandamus. Those are very, very complicated cases, no? But now, there is a new rule wherein I think start today, no? That the jurisdiction of the MTC, no? There are four kinds of MTC, no? Metropolitan Trial Court. I was a former Metropolitan Trial Court, Branch 74 in Taguig City. I was a former Municipal Trial Court in Cainta, no? So, as an MTC judge, the Supreme Court expanded the jurisdiction of the MTC, no? Meaning to say that before admiralty cases, only RTC judges. Now, MTC judges, courts can have jurisdiction effective today, no? Today is the effectivity of that new law, expanded the jurisdiction of the MTC, no? Admiralty, action in rem, no? Real action, yes. They are given the chance, no? Damages, no? Tinaasa na yung damages, no? Also, even a probit of a will, no? Can you imagine that? Probit of a will, no? Before, RTC lang, kami lang, no? In the state proceedings or probit of a will, no? But now, it is expanded. The jurisdiction of the MTC are now expanded, no? So remember that, no? The new law took effect today because kailan ba? I think August 6, no? Pinablish in a general newspaper, no? After 15 days, yun, pumasok na, no? 15 days. So therefore, ngayon nga ang effectivity ng ating expanded jurisdiction of the MTC. I pity the MTC because when I was an MTC judge, in Taguig, I have 12,000 active cases. If there is now an expanded jurisdiction of the MTC, they are flooded with so many cases, no? When I was an MTC judge of Cainta, Rizal, I have more than 10,000 active cases, no? When I was appointed as an RTC judge in Binangonan, no? I have more than 1,000 cases as an RTC judge. When I was promoted as an RTC judge in Manila, I have only around 600 cases, no? Lahat na yon, no? Civil, criminal, special proceedings, so on and so forth, no? I pity the MTC judges because of this expanded jurisdiction. Buti na lang, hindi ko pa pinablish ang aking libro, no? Because I have written a book, no? On remedial law, no? So, I was advised by the LED, Legal Education Board, that I have to chop my book, no? On civil procedure, no? There is volume 1, no? And volume 2. Buti na lang, hindi ko pa pinablish because of the latest amendments of our rule support expanding the jurisdiction of the MTC, no? Courts, no? So, I was advised by the LEB that I have to chop my book, no? Ang kapal sana ng libro ko, no? But I have to chop it, no? Buti na lang, hindi pa na-publish, no? So, volume 1, from rule 1 up to rule 39, no? Volume 2 will be rule 40 up to rule 71. In from rule 1 up to rule 39, that includes summary procedure, that includes katarungan pambarangay law. Although I have written a book on katarungan pambarangay law, this is the book of katarungan pambarangay law, wherein I was this is the latest edition, no? Wherein there are so many already local government units and barangays bought this book, no? So this is, no? So katarungan pambarangay law will be a part of volume 1 of the civil procedure, but majority of my book that was sold to the law students and who will take the bar is my book on legal ethics, no? Because this is a 2021 rules 2021 edition, no? There are so many, I was flooded with so many orders on my book on legal ethics because I discussed more than 600 cases decided by the Supreme Court on legal ethics, no? Latest decision of the Supreme Court in legal ethics. Although I also have books on a guide in Dangerous Drugs Act, no? This is a 2021 edition. Anyway, as I've said that my book, I have to chop it down, no? Volume 1 and volume 2. Anyway, so still the parties can submit their memorandum. Okay. It was asked in the bar, what is the effect if there is an agreed statement of facts by the parties? It was asked in the bar examination. What will be the effect if there is an agreed statement of facts? You know, during trial and even during pre-trial, there is a stipulation of facts. No? For instance, I am the complainant. Then I will ask the defendants. No? Will the defendant admit that the complainant and the respondents are close relatives? Admitted, Your Honor. So that is an agreed fact. So, will the defendant admit that the defendants borrowed money to the complainant in the amount of 5 million? Admitted, Your Honor. So that is an agreed fact. So, will the defendant admit that in the promissory note there is a 12% interest? Admitted, Your Honor. So what will happen if there is an agreed statement of facts? No? The Supreme Court rule, if the parties agree in writing, kailangan pala in writing. Anyway, we reduce it into writing. No? On the facts involved in action, they may be asked to render judgment without introduction of evidence. So if the parties agree on the statement of facts, then they can ask the court to render judgment based on the agreed statement of facts. No? It was decided by the Supreme Court. No? So, in the case of MacGyver versus Manufacturers Life Insurance Company, 87 Philippines, page 330, the Supreme Court give wisdom on the agreed statement. The Supreme Court ruled, it was us in the bar, may an agreed statement of facts be the basis of a judgment? And why? Your answer will be yes. And the reason is that the agreed statement of facts is conclusive. Remember, no? Yes. And that the agreed statement of facts is conclusive between the parties. Remember, it was decided by the Supreme Court and it was us in the bar. No? Yes, the reason is that the agreed statement of facts is conclusive to the parties, not only to the parties, according to the Supreme Court, as well as to the courts. No? It is not only conclusive to the parties, that is why they can ask for judgment based on the agreed statement of facts, because it is conclusive not only to the parties, but also to the court. No? And that the Supreme Court says that neither the parties can withdraw the agreement. Can you imagine that? Neither the parties can withdraw the agreement, nor the court ignore the same. No? This is a very nice decision of the Supreme Court. The parties cannot withdraw said agreed agreement, nor the court ignore the same. Remember the case of MacGyver versus Manufacturers Life Insurance Company, 87, Iskra, page, Philippines, page 370. Okay. So, we'll now proceed with another topic. No? Our topic, next topic will be calendar and adjournment. No? So, before... the continuous trial is only applicable to criminal cases. But now, because of the 2019 rules on civil procedure, even civil cases is under the rules on continuous trial. No? So, who will be the one? The clerk of court is the right hand of the judge. No? So, the clerk of court will be the one to calendar all cases to be tried, no? But there will be preference on habeas corpus, election cases, special civil action, no? So there are preferences, no? Not only habeas corpus but also writ of habeas data, writ of amparo, and writ of kalikasan, no? Those are cases wherein the clerk court will have a preference of the calendar of cases. The notice of trial, no? The clerk court will send notices to the parties, no? Either, LBC now is the authorized courier of the Supreme Court, no? There are authorized courier of the Supreme Court, no? We have process server. Yung process server, pwede siya mag-serve. Also, the our sheriff, no? So, the process server and the sheriff will serve personally the notice, no? Or we can send it through mail, registered mail, no? Pero mas maganda talaga sa LBC, no? Sa LBC. And then, the court may adjourn trial from day to day as expeditious and convenience, no? But, the adjournment of trial shall no longer more than 1 month. No? Pinaka-maximum ito, 1 month, but not more than 3 months. When I lectured in the Philippine Judicial Academy, because I lectured judges, I told judges that we are not allowed to postpone hearings more than 3 months. I told them when I lectured to the judges, because I'm also a lecturer of Philippine Judicial Academy. So I told the judges that, you know, Your Honors, no? Although we are the same now, we are same now, judges, no? But I still respect them, no? Your Honors, Your Honors, I still say, Your Honors, judges, Your Honors, remember, we cannot reset or postpone cases more than 3 months. Because there are so many judges who set the case 6 months, 10 months, so 5 months. Except there is a, what we call, a approval from the Supreme Court. So I told them that you must write to the Chief Justice or to the Office of the Administrator that allowing you to reset more than 3 months. But how about this pandemic? Okay. It might be us in the bar. Can a judge postpone or reset a case more than 3 months? What will be your answer? The answer is yes. Because of this pandemic and that the courts are physically closed. Remember, compañeros and compañeras, I saw Fiscal Mario Luna, no? Watching also. No? Fiscal, good evening, Fiscal. No? I saw some of the my friend prosecutors and judges also watching. Because of the pandemic, all courts are now are physically closed. No, we only allowed to have electronic filing of pleadings. No, and that there is a video conference hearing. No, through remote control. No, it is now allowed. No, before you must ask the Supreme Court to allow you to have a video conference hearing, but now. Because of the pandemic, yes. Because of the pandemic, although it is not allowed, it is not allowed because of the physical closure of the courts. No. So remember that, compañeros and compañeras. No. Next, what are the requisites in order that the court can allow postponement of cases? No. So, what are the, for instance, witness is sick, the lawyer is sick, or witnesses are beyond the control of the court because they are abroad. So, what are the requisites? A motion to postpone a trial on the ground of the absence of the evidence can be granted only upon affidavit. Now, there must be an affidavit showing the materiality of the evidence expected to be obtained and that due diligence was used, no? Then the facts that the court will allow, no? In meritorious cases, no? You know, in my case, if the lawyer says, Your Honor, I'm sorry that I asked for postponement because my witness, supposed witness, is sick. So I said, okay, I will require you to submit an affidavit and the medical certificate signed by the doctor and duly notarized. So that will be my requirements, no? Because there is now a postponement fee, no? We require the lawyers to pay a postponement fee, no? We don't allow. So there are, under the new rules on civil procedure, there are requirements in order that the court can allow the postponement. No? What are the requisites to postpone trial of illness of a party or counsel? A motion to postpone trial on the ground of illness of a party or the lawyer or counsel may be granted if it appears from said affidavit that his appearance is indispensable, no? So those are other requirements in order that there will be a valid postponement, no? How about COVID-19? Yes, and COVID yung lawyer or your witness, can we postpone that? Yes, we can postpone it because there is a Delta variant that is very, very contagious disease. Annual conference of pending cases. So, when I lecture to judges, I told them that you should exercise this annual conference of pending cases. Because under the rules of court, data judges should conduct an annual conference of pending cases. At the end of 1 year from the day the trial proper has commenced, and every year thereafter, if the trial has not been terminated, the judge shall call the parties and their counsel to a conference to devise ways and means of terminating the trial. A statement of the result of the conference signed by the judge and counsel shall be attached to the record showing the reason why the trial was not terminated, the number and names of witnesses to be presented, and the stipulation of facts. No? So, we'll submit that to the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. So, you know, I always conducted, because, you know, we have monthly inventory, we have quarterly inventory, and semi-annually inventory. Kapag nakita ko that this case, natulog, no, sleeping for more than a year or 6 months, I set the case for an annual conference. No? Bakit kaya natulog ito? Bakit kaya the lawyers did not file pleadings? Sometimes kasi, hindi namin napapansin because we have so many cases that there are cases already naburo na, sleeping. So that is why really there must be an annual conference of pending cases. So I told my staff to set the annual conference of cases that sleep for a while. No? So I sent notices to the lawyers, to the parties. No? Then if they appeared, then I asked them what will happen. Why the after the termination of the pre-trial conference and that the court set the case for initial presentation of the complainant's evidence, the complainant did not present evidence. So I will just, I talk to them that under the rules of court, under the circular of the Supreme Court, we will conduct an annual conference of pending cases. No? So, if I ask the parties, what happened? Sir, nag-ayos na po kami. Okay, nag-settle na pala sila but they did not inform the court. I told them, you must manifest to the court or file the corresponding motion that you already settled your case. No? Okay, bawas sa kaso ko. Or they said that my witnesses are abroad. No, we could not contact my witnesses. No, so I asked the complainant if I will dismiss the case provisionally. Okay, Panyero, will you, I will just dismiss the case provisionally for failure to prosecute. Is it okay to you? During the annual conference of pending cases, if the lawyer agree, okay, Your Honor, dismiss it. So I will dismiss the case for failure to prosecute without prejudice. No? It should be without prejudice. Kasi pag nilagyan ko ng with prejudice, it could no longer be revived. No? So that there must be without prejudice. If it is without prejudice, the lawyer can still file a motion to revive the case. Same with criminal cases, no? In criminal cases, if the accused could not be located, could not be arrested, then in order that this case will not be inactive, then we will send it to the archive. Kapag ang accused will be arrested, or if the court acquires jurisdiction over the person of the accused, then the prosecutor can file a motion to revive the case. No? So, remember that, compañeros, compañeras, that the judge can archive cases, both civil and criminal, can even dismiss it without prejudice. No? So, that is the annual contest. That is why the purpose, you know, when I was a new judge, sabi ko, what is the purpose why there must be an annual conference of cases? I found out that there are really cases na natulog, no, matagal, no? There are no other pleadings filed, no? Kaya natulog, no? So, because of that, annual conference of pending cases is very, very helpful, not only to the court, not only to the parties, not only to the public, no? In order to unclog the dockets of the court. We can ask that the case will be archived. We can ask that the case will be dismissed for failure to prosecute, but without prejudice, meaning to say that it can be revived, no? But you must file a corresponding motion to revive. Okay, we now proceed with subpoena, no? You know, in subpoena, there are two kinds of a subpoena, no? Subpoena doces tecum and subpoena ad testi picandum. So, what is a subpoena, no? If it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? A subpoena is a process directed to a person requiring him to attend and to testify at the hearing or at the trial of an action or any investigation conducted by the in the Philippines, no? Or by taking his or her deposition. Then, if the person to be subpoenaed were directed to bring any books, documents, or things under his control, then it is called subpoena doces tecum. So there are two kinds of a subpoena. Subpoena ad testi picandum and subpoena doces tecum. Okay. So, if, you know, sometimes I issued a subpoena to the parties or to the witnesses, both subpoena ad testi picandum and subpoena doces tecum. Okay. By whom? Sino pwede mag-issue ng subpoena? No? So, who are authorized to subpoena, to issue subpoena? So, the court or judge before whom the witness is required to attend. Or by justices of the Supreme Court or the Court of Appeals. And if the prisoner is confined in a jail, then what will happen if the person to be subpoenaed is a detention prisoner, convicted, na? Convicted na siya. Can we issue a subpoena to the believed prison to bring the accused? The answer is no. Especially if the accused was convicted of a heinous crime, no? So, if we subpoena is a pag sa BJMP, walang problema, pending pa yung kaso eh. Yung mga convicted na prisoners who are now in the Muntinlupa felony, we will go there, no? So, we'll go there in Muntinlupa, because in Muntinlupa, there are 12 RTC courts, no? There are 12 RTC courts and 6 MTC courts, no? So, I always go there and conducted a hearing inside the penal colony, no? Because we are not allowed to subpoena the bucor or the jail warden to bring the accused outside the penitentiary because he's already a convicted criminal. So remember, future compañeros and compañeras, that if the witness is a prisoner, convicted prisoner, then the judge could not subpoena. We'll go there and we will try the case. You know, also in women's correctional, no? I have so many cases wherein the conducted hearing in women correctional, no? Because I have thousands of cases in drugs, no? Also other cases, no? So, pupunta kami sa women's correctional sa Mandaluyong, and we will conducted our hearing there, no? Because the Supreme Court don't allow us that we will issue a subpoena to, so that the warden will bring the convicted prisoner outside the court and to testify in court. Not only that, it is very, very risky. Risky masyado, baka tumakas pa, no? Baka tumakas pa yung mga prisoners. Okay. What are the forms and contents of the subpoena? The subpoena shall be designed by the clerk of court or by the judge, no? Under the seal of the court. So this is the subpoena, no? Ginagawa namin yan, no? Bahala na ang clerk of court o yung aming staff paggawa ng subpoena, no? Provided there is the name of the court, no? Like me, I'm RTC Judge of Manila, National Capital Judicial Region, Regional Trial Court, Branch 26, Manila City, Philippines. So that is so the name of the court, the title of the case. So for instance, the case is murder. So murder. Then persons to be subpoenaed, Mr. Juan de la Cruz, no? And to bring the following documents, no? Medical certificate, birth certificate, marriage contract, so on and so forth, no? So it must state the name of the court, the title of the action, the person to be directed to attend, and that it will also have description on the books, documents, or things demanded by the witness to appear in court and to testify, no? So dosis subpoena, dosis take home, and ad testificandum, to testify and to bring documents. So what will happen if always ask in the bar, can you quash a subpoena? If it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? Yes, you can quash a subpoena. So what are the grounds in order that you can quash a subpoena? No? The court, upon motion made by the parties promptly before the time is specified in the subpoena, dosis tecum or ad testificandum, the parties can quash the subpoena. No? Yes, you can quash the subpoena if it is, number one, remember this, if it will be asked in the bar, what are the grounds, can a subpoena be quashed? Your answer will be yes. What are, if yes, what are the grounds? Number one, grounds, it is unreasonable. It is unreasonable. Second, it is oppressive. It is oppressive. Then, if it is a subpoena, dosis tecum, no? To bring documents, the documents is irrelevant. The documents does not appear to be relevant to the issue, no? And that, the last one, no? The person to whose behalf the subpoena issued fails to advance the cause of the production thereof. Kasi dapat mag-advance yung parties na gustong the witness to bring those documents, dapat mag-advance ng pera na for the production of those documents. So remember, yes, you can quash both subpoena ad testificandum and dosis tecum. No? It is unreasonable, it is oppressive, it is not relevant books, and that it is the there is no advance money for the reproduction of those documents. No, kailangan magbigay muna ng pera. para i-xerox yung dokumento, no? Those are, remember that, if it will be asked in the bar, yes, both subpoena docis tecum and subpoena ad testificandum can be quash. Number one, it is unreasonable, oppressive, irrelevant, or the party in whose behalf subpoena was issued, he failed to advance reasonable cause of the production. Okay. Can a party ignore a subpoena? And if he will ignore, can that party or witness be disciplined by the judge or can be cited in contempt? There are two kinds of contempt of court, no? One is direct contempt. The other one is indirect contempt. And there is also what they call criminal complaint, criminal contempt, and civil contempt. Okay. So, indirect contempt, direct contempt, civil contempt, criminal contempt. Can the parties ignore subpoena? Okay, we'll discuss first. No, the answer is no. We'll discuss first. Who will be the one to serve the subpoena? No. So, who will be the one to serve the subpoena? The sheriff will be the one to serve the subpoena, or his deputy, or our process server. No. Provided the party is not less than 18 years of age, no. Then how about summons? Can process server serve the summons? The answer is no. It should be the sheriff who will serve the summons, because the sheriff should always have a report, no? Kasi kung hindi tatanggapin, ibato lang niya, then considered as served, no? So he will make a sheriff's report to the court why he failed to serve it personally. Okay, so if you ignore the disciplina, then you can be cited in contempt. Remember that, compañeros and compañeras. I have so many, you know, there was a mayor, active mayor in Ilocos that I subpoenaed in order that the mayor will testify in court in a murder case. The mayor ignored it. So I sent it 3 times. Because the mayor ignored it, I cited the mayor in contempt of court. Hindi ko muna siya pinakulong. In my contempt of court, sabi ko, mayor, because you ignore my subpoena, I will fine you 1,000 pesos. And that in case of insolvency, kulong ng 3 araw. So, the mayor, because of my contempt, he appeared in court. So sabi ko, mayor, dumating ka, I will now withdraw my contempt to you, no? And that I will no longer allow you, huwag ka na mag post ng fine, no? So he testified. After he testified, I allowed him to go back to his province, to the province, no? So I mean to say that if you ignore a subpoena, then you can be cited in contempt of court, and you can be in prison or you can be fined. Okay, we now proceed with presentation of evidence, rule 132 of the rules of court, no? meaning to say, we now proceed with trial. Trial proper. Rule 132 is the rule on trial proper, no? So, rule 132. Okay? So, presentation of evidence. Rule 132 of the rules on evidence. Examination of witnesses. Section 1. The testimony of witnesses shall be given orally in open court and under oath or affirmation. So, it should be orally in open court and under oath or affirmation. Even on a video conference trial or hearing, there must also be under oath and affirmation, although it is a video conference hearing, no? So every time that I set the case for hearing through video conference, I ask my staff to let the witness be sworn. Will you tell the truth? Nothing but the truth in these proceedings? Why? Because he can be cited. He can be, if he is telling a lie, then he can be perjury, can be filed against him, no? So, the testimony in courts must be in writing. That is why we have a stenographer. In superior courts, from the Supreme Court down to MTC, the testimony of each witness shall be taken in shorthand or stenotype. Then the name of the witness, the residence, occupation must be stated. All questions put to the witness and in his answer thereto must be included. If the question is objected to and the objection is ruled, then the nature of the objection and the ground, no? So all must be stated in the transcript, stenographic notes, no? Then, if the witness declines to answer the question, then it must also be entered into the records of the case. The transcript of record shall be made by the official stenographer or stenotype and certified to be correct a statement of such testimony and proceeding. So, the witness must testify in open court, although there is now what we call judicial affidavit rule. Despite that, there is already a judicial affidavit that is considered as his direct examination, but the witness must also identify his or her judicial affidavit, no? So he will testify that is his or her judicial affidavit. For instance, he will testify under oath, no? Then, for instance, open court, no? Will you swear that you will tell the truth, nothing but the truth? Okay, now state your name, okay, your address, your occupation, and other personal circumstances. So, then, okay, for instance, there is a judicial affidavit. Then the witness, the lawyer will say, Mr. Witness, showing to you this judicial affidavit, what can you say of this? Sir, this is my judicial affidavit. Okay. In the last page of the judicial affidavit, there is a signature on top of the name Juan de la Cruz. Who is this signature? That is my signature, sir. Okay. That this there is a signature over the printed name Attorney Juan de la Cruz, counsel for the complainant. Oh, signature, that is the signature of my lawyer, sir. Okay. So, the witness is ready for cross. For instance, before the witness will be cross-examined, if there is a judicial affidavit, the opposing lawyer must raise his or her objection to the judicial affidavit. Why? If he will not raise his objection, then it is deemed waived. So the court will ask the opposing counsel, okay, compañero, ready for cross? Yes, Your Honor, but before I will conduct my cross-examination based on the judicial affidavit, I will raise my objection. Question number 5. It is a leading question. So, question number 8. It is a misleading question. Question number 15. It is a legal conclusion. Question number 16. It is a vague question. Question number 22. It is an opinion. Question number 36. This is a legal conclusion. Question number 45. This is a compound question. So, all of your questions, all of your objections, before you will conduct your cross-examination based on the judicial affidavit, you must raise all your objection. Why? Because it is deemed waived. I have a case wherein this is a case of violation of the Central Bank Act against a bank, a development bank. Documents to be presented, and that judicial affidavit is around 2,000 pages, and the documents around one truck, no, mumpuno inside my my courtroom. Then I said, okay, after the witness identified babae ito, her affidavit, sabi ko, okay, ready for cross. Okay, before you cross-examine, you must raise your objection. Sabi na lawyer, Your Honor, give me enough time to raise my objection because the judicial affidavit is around 2,800 pages and the attached documents is more than 50,000 documents. How can I raise my objection? Because I have to examine one by one of all the questions, of all the documents attached, and of all the documents that they will give me. Kahit sikot-sikot po, hindi mailagay lahat sa napakarami nito. So I ask the court that I be given enough time. Can the judge grant that? Because under the 2019 Rules of Civil Procedure, kailangan either orally or in writing. Yes, I granted. Why? Bakit? To give due process, no? Napakakapal yung dokumento, no? So he reduced it into writing, no? I allowed him to reduce all his objections in writing. So that is for instance, objection, Your Honor. I object question number 5. It is a leading question. Then the court will decide. Objection overruled. Question number 5 calls for this is a preliminary matters. Objection number 15. Misleading questions. Granted. This is a misleading question. Question number 25. Objection that the question is illegal conclusion. Granted, this is a legal conclusion. So, after the lawyer raised his objection, under the new rules of civil procedure, the judge will immediately rule on the objection. And all those ruling of the judge and all the objections must be recorded in the transcript, stenographic notes, and signed by the stenographer. Can the parties and lawyers ask for a correction on the entry of the transcript, stenographic notes? The answer is yes. For instance, may error instead na di ako pumatay. Nakalagay dito, ako ang pumatay. So, no, Your Honor, the answer is, can the court allow proper correction on the stenographic notes? The answer is yes. No? Pero ang gagawin muna namin, I will direct the stenographer that the parties will hear first with the tape recorder. Kasi meron kaming tape recorder, maliit lang. So, all of us will listen kung tama yung pag-transcribe ng aming stenographer. If that it is wrong, then we will direct, I will direct my stenographer to correct and countersign it. No? Yes, we can correct the, if there is a wrong or mistake in transcribing the stenographic notes. Can a witness bound to answer all the questions asked by the lawyers? So, what will be your answer? It will be asked in the bar. A witness must answer questions pertinent to the matters at issue. Though the answer may tend to establish a claim against him, but unless otherwise provided by law, he need not give an answer which will have a tendency to subject him to punishment for an offense, nor need to give an answer that will have to direct tendency to degrade his character, unless it is very fact of the issue or the fact of the issue are presumed. But the witness must answer the fact of his previous conviction of an offense. As a general rule, future compañeros and compañeras, although there are lawyers and prosecutors I saw watching, no? That the witness must answer all questions, no? Even it is incriminatory. Who will be the one to protect the witness? It is the lawyer. Objection, Your Honor. The question is incriminatory. It will incriminate my witness. So, let your lawyer protect you. Let your lawyer raise the objection. Let the lawyer argue, no? You know, every time that there is an argument, objection, Your Honor, the question is calls for a legal conclusion. Then I will direct the parties to argue. No, to argue. Then the court will rule whether objection sustained. If the court ruled to sustain the objection, then the judge will say, reform your question. If the judge will overrule the objection, objection overruled, then the judge will say, witness may answer. Counsel proceed. So, as a general rule, it is the lawyer who will protect the witness if the answer are objectionable, no? Because if the lawyer fails to raise his or her objection, then it is deemed waived. How about future compañeros and compañeras, and lawyers here and prosecutors, if the court denied it, no? Objection, Your Honor, sustained. Can the lawyer make a proper of evidence? Can a lawyer make a proper of evidence? The answer is yes, Your Honor, because the court sustained the objection. Can I make a proper of evidence? Then the judge will say, yes, proceed, Panyero. If the court did not sustain the objection, the witness will testify that, so on and so forth. It is called a proper of evidence. And that the proper of evidence will be also recorded in the transcript of record. And that the proper of evidence now, the proper of evidence can be used on appeal. No? Siyempre, kapag ang judge ay sinustain yung objection, hindi niya gagamitin proper of evidence. What is the purpose? Why you should make a proper of evidence? Because you can use it on appeal. No? Remember that, future compañeros and compañeras and compañeros, compañeras who are listening here. Then, what are the order of examination of individual witnesses? Number one, direct examination. Although we have now a judicial affidavit rule. The judicial affidavit rule will now a direct examination. So, direct examination, then cross-examination, then redirect examination, then recross examination. Okay. So, direct examination, after direct examination, cross-examination, after cross-examination, redirect examination, then recross examination. Always ask in the bar, what is a direct examination? Are leading questions allowed in a direct examination? Always ask in the bar, are direct examinations allowed? What is a direct examination? Are leading questions allowed in the direct examination? If it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? So, this is the meaning of a direct examination. It does not mean that it is answerable by yes or no. Akala ninyo, it is a leading question. If the answer is answerable by yes or no, the answer is that you are wrong. A leading question is a question that suggests the witness the answer. Hindi kailangan yes or no. It suggests the witness to answer the question that the parties desires, is a leading question. On direct examination, leading questions are not allowed. So leading questions are not allowed in a direct examination, except the following, no? In direct examination, leading questions are not allowed except the following. Number one, preliminary matters. Preliminary matters. Second, if there is a difficulty in getting a direct and intelligent answer from the witness who is ignorant, child of tender age, a feeble-minded, or a deep mute. So, as a general rule, leading questions are not allowed in a direct examination, except number one, preliminary matters. Questions on a ignorant witnesses, or a child of tender age, or a feeble-minded, or a deep mute. So, those are the exception to the rule. I will discuss later on my case that the witness, the star witness, was a deaf mute. No? So, deaf mute cannot speak. No? Cannot speak. Sign language only. Okay. So, that is direct examination. No? Well, does that mean it is answerable by yes or no? But it suggests a question. Remember that. That in leading questions, it does not mean that it is answerable by yes or no. How about unwilling witness or hostile witness? It can, what are leading questions allowed for a hostile or an unwilling witness? Section 6 of Rule 132. A witness may interrogate any unwilling or hostile witness by a leading question. So, under Rule 6, under Section 6, Rule 132 of the Rules of Civil Procedure on Evidence, you can ask questions or interrogate a hostile or unwilling witness by a leading question. So, that is another exception to the rule wherein a leading questions are allowed in a direct examination. A party may call an adverse party or an officer, director or manager, managing agent of a public or private corporation or partnership or association and interrogate him by leading questions and contradict and impeach him in all respect if he have been called by the adverse party, and the witness may be called, may be contradicted or impeached for on his behalf. No? So, you know, for my 23 years as a judge, I always observe that there are hostile witnesses, no? Or unwilling witnesses. So I said, okay, prosecutor, a drug case, no? Karamihan sa mga hostile witness or unwilling witness yung mga drug cases. Present your witness. Okay, I will present my witness, a police officer or a barangay official, no? Then, when the prosecutor asks questions, he found out that the witness is an unwilling witness or a hostile witness, kakampi sa kabila, sa accused. So, if the prosecutor or the lawyer feels that his witness is an unwilling witness or a hostile witness, witness pala sa kabila, what he will do? He can impeach. He can ask a leading questions on his unwilling witness or his hostile witness. Your Honor, I feel that this witness, barangay, punong barangay Juan de la Cruz, is a hostile witness to the prosecution. Because of that, Your Honor, may I ask the Honorable Court that I be allowed to impeach this witness and interrogate him through a leading questions. Then the judge will say, granted, because the witness is a hostile witness, unwilling witness for the prosecution, you are not allowed to ask a leading question, although it is a direct testimony. Another question. May a party impeach his own witness? If it will be asked in the bar, what will be your answer? The answer is yes. The party producing a witness is not allowed to impeach his credit by evidence of bad faith, but may counteract him by any other evidence and in the discretion of the court. So, kailangan pa rin namin ng consent, no? That in the discretion of the court, to show that the witness has misled him in calling him in the witness stand, and that his testimony is inconsistent, then he can impeach his own witness. Your Honor, when I call this witness, I hope and I pray that he is my witness. But when I ask questions, he is a hostile witness. He is an unwilling witness. Then I move, Your Honor, to impeach my own witness. Can the judge grant it? Yes, we can grant it. Then the judge will say, after observing the demeanor and the answer of this witness, this court is in the opinion that indeed this witness misled you in calling as your prosecution witness. He is indeed a hostile or unwilling witness. I will grant Panyero to impeach your own witness. So as a general rule, the lawyer, the party, cannot impeach his own witness. But there must be the judge will allow you, no? If that you were misled by that witness and you find out that he is unwilling or hostile witness, then the judge or the court will allow you to impeach that witness. So how you impeach the witness? No? How? Because you were misled in calling that witness. So you can impeach him by from other any other other evidence, no? Showing that this witness is a witness of the accused. Alam niyo, in my experience, majority dito pag drug cases, no, yung mga media personnel nagtestify for in behalf of the prosecution, doon pala sa kabila, police officers and barangay officials, no, I observed that, no, when I conducted hearing on drug cases. So if it will be asked in the bar, may a party impeach his own witness, the answer is yes. So remember that the party or the lawyer can impeach his or her own witness. Then how about cross-examination? After direct examination, the judge will say cross-examination. Okay. Before that, no, I have a case when I was a new judge. That when I called the case, then the prosecution, private prosecutor, this is there is private, said, Your Honor, my first call your witness, Panyero. Okay, Your Honor, there is a private prosecutor. Your Honor, my first witness is the accused himself. Then the prosecution objected, no. The defense counsel object, no, Your Honor, I will allow that my witness, the accused himself, will be a witness for the prosecution. I will not allow that. Then the prosecutor said, no, the witness himself is our star witness. There was a case that reached to the Supreme Court because the judge allowed it. Can the judge allow the accused to be a witness against himself? The answer is no. No. The accused have the right against self-incrimination. Hindi pwede, no? Hindi siya pwede maging witness for the prosecution, no? So it was already decided by the Supreme Court. In that leading case, the RTC judge allowed the prosecution that his first witness is was the accused himself. So remember that. Okay, after the direct examination, the judge will say cross. Okay, Your Honor, cross examination. So what are the scope and the purpose and the extent of a cross examination? Is leading question allowed or is misleading questions not allowed? What will be your answer? It will be asked in the bar. Upon determination of the direct examination, the witness may be cross-examined by the adverse party as to any matters stated in the direct examination or connected therewith, with sufficient fullness and freedom to test his accuracy and truthfulness and freedom from interest or bias or the reverse, and to elicit material facts bearing upon the issue. On cross-examination, remember, compañeros, compañeras, future compañeros, compañeras, on cross-examination, leading questions are allowed, but not a misleading question. So, in cross-examination, leading questions are allowed, not misleading question. So, if cross-examination, objection, Your Honor, the witness, the answer of the before the witness will answer the question during the cross-examination, if the question asked by the opposing lawyer who conducted the direct examination or examination in chief, the lawyer should raise his objection before the witness will answer the question. Why? If the witness already answered, then the court will say, objection overruled. The witness already answered the question. So, what will you do that the answer always immediately answer the question? You must ask the court to caution the witness not to answer immediately the question asked by the lawyer. Your Honor, may I beg the indulgence of the Honorable Court that the court will warn the witness not immediately answer the question, and that the witness be warned not to look on his lawyer because the lawyer is coaching this witness. Can you do that? Yes. You ask and you manifest the court that the witness immediately answer the questions by looking on the eyes of his or her lawyer. So the judge will say, witness, Mr. Witness, Madam Witness, please do not answer the questions immediately because there might be an objection, and that you are not allowed to look on your lawyer because the lawyer can coach his or her witness. So remember that, compañeros, compañeras, that that in cross-examination, misleading questions are not allowed. Only leading questions. So, what will happen if witness already finished his or her direct examination and cross examination? There was already, compañeros, compañeras, in my experience as a judge for 23 long years, I observed that during the cross examination, the lawyer will raise his objection that, objection, Your Honor. The question asked were touched during the direct examination. So, if it was not touched during the direct examination, is it objectionable? I always overrule the objection. Objection, overruled. Why I overrule the objection? Because I said the cross examiner is given a very wide latitude in conducting his cross examination. As long as even it is outside the direct examination, as long as it is relevant to the issue, it is material to the issue, it is not foreign to the issue. So remember, future compañeros and compañeras, that even when you conducted a cross-examination, even it is outside the scope of the direct examination, you are still allowed to ask questions, because in cross-examination, the cross-examiner is given a very, very wide latitude, but not in redirect examination and the recross examination. In redirect examination, you are not allowed to ask questions not touched during the cross examination. Neither on redirect examination or recross, you cannot conduct a recross examination not within or not outside the scope of the redirect examination. I will discuss it later on. But as long as you know, you must always raise your objection. Then you argue. You know, I have a very, very nice, unforgettable experience when I hear the case of the Marcoses, wherein the lead counsel of the Philippine government is the former Solicitor General Frank Chavez, together with the DOJ Secretary and Undersecretaries, with more than 10 lawyers for the prosecution. Then the defense also more than 10 lawyers. So when I conducted the hearing, I asked the prosecution, there are so many lawyers. The prosecution have more than 10 lawyers. The defense have also more than 10 lawyers. May I know who is the lead counsel for the prosecution and who will be the lead counsel for the defense? So, Solicitor General Frank Chavez stood up and said, I'm the lead counsel, Your Honor, being the Solicitor General, the lawyer of the Republic of the Philippines. How about the lawyers of the Marcoses? There are a battery of lawyers. Then the lawyer stood up. I am the lead counsel, Your Honor. Okay, I will allow other lawyers to argue. Because if all of you will be allowed to talk and argue, then we are like a marketplace. So, only two lawyers are allowed. So, when Imelda Marcos testified, Frank Chavez stood up and said, objection, Your Honor. The question is irrelevant, immaterial to the issue. I said, objection, Mr. Solicitor General, denied. Motion for reconsideration, Your Honor. Then he argued with so many amjur, no, American jurisprudence, no, the lawyers are amjur, the amjur. Then argue both parties. They argue, no, bak-bakan. Then Motion for reconsideration denied. Namula na si Frank Chavez. Second motion for reconsideration, Your Honor. Sabi niya, because I believe the court should sustain my objection. Don't you know, Your Honor, that I'm magna cum laude, University of the Philippines, number 4 in the bar. Summa cum laude, Master of Laws, Harvard University. Doctor of Laws, magna cum laude, Yale University. Sabi ko, hindi. Then the lawyer of the Marcos said, Ateneo de Manila University, number 1 in the bar. Summa cum laude, Harvard University. Summa cum laude, Yale University. Sabi ko, hindot. So, they try to skirt me. So, I bang my gavel. Okay, if all of you are magna cum laude, number 1 in the bar, I'm more than number 1 because I'm the judge here. Shout out! Or else, I will set you in contempt. So, I have to stood my ground. So, I always stand my ground. If you're not satisfied, go to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court sustain my decision. Future compañeros, compañeras, my affirmation of my decision to the Supreme Court is 99%. I have only one reversal. All of my decisions were sustained and affirmed by the Supreme Court in bank or division. I'm the only judge that have almost 100% affirmation. That is why my name always inscribed in scra. My name is inscribed in different scra. So, once you become a lawyer and a judge, you must stand your ground. You must stand your ground. Okay. So, you know, future compañeros, compañeras, I encountered so many best lawyers in town, but I stand my ground. Okay, we now proceed, no? We proceed with redirect examination. How about the right to inspect writings shown to the witness? For instance, Mr. Witness, show it to you this document, a guide in Dangerous Drugs Act authored by Judge Pampilo. Can you look on it and what can you say about this document? Can a lawyer ask the court, Your Honor, before said documents will be shown to the witness, I ask Your Honor that I will examine first the documents. Can you do that? Yes. So, whatever writing is shown to a witness, it may be inspected by the opposing counsel. But you are always asked the court that you will be given a chance to inspect whatever documents or writing shown to the witness. Your Honor, may I have, grant me to inspect first the book, the documents, before it will be shown to the witness. So, how about if the witness wanted to repress her memory, wanted to browse a particular document, can the court allow him or her to repress his or her memory, or he may refer to a memorandum? The answer is yes. It will be asked in the bar, your answer is yes. And this is the best answer. A witness may be allowed to repress his memory respecting a fact by anything written by himself or under the direction at the time when the pact occurred, or immediately thereafter, or any other time when the pact was pressed in his or her memory, and he or she know that the same was correct, stated in the writing. But in case the writing may be produced, may be inspected by the other party, so he may choose. Cross-examine it and read it in evidence. So, as a general rule, if the witness wanted to repress his or her memory, the court will allow it. Okay? The witness is allowed to repress his memory, dig up your documents, and testify to the court. Yes, it is allowed. And that, for instance, in that writing, only part of the writing, the lawyer marked it. For instance, Your Honor, the first page will be marked as our Exhibit A, the second page, A-1, A-2, but the last page, the three last pages were not marked. Can you also use it as your common evidence? The answer is yes. A party can also mark this. Your Honor, I will mark it also as our common evidence, as Exhibit 1, the first page, the second page, 1-A, up to the last page. Yes, if there is a book, a document, memorandum, marked by the lawyer, you can also it mark as your common exhibit, because it is allowed by law. How about when part of the transaction or writing in evidence, are the remainder is also admissible? The answer is yes. When part of an act, declaration, conversation, or writing is given in evidence by one party, the whole or the same subject may be inquired into by the other. When a detached act, declaration, or conversation, or writing necessary for its understanding may be given in evidence. So, if the documents, like this book, is presented to the witness, and the witness testified, and it was marked, then you can also use it as your evidence. No? You can manifest that, Your Honor, that in this document, there are superimposition. That in this document, there are erasures. So therefore, Your Honor, the superimposition, the erasures, will be marked as our exhibit, because we believe that this is a forged document. But only the court can say it is a forged document. No? So you can mark it. No? When a part of an act, declaration, conversation, or writing is given in evidence, remember that, Peter Compatias, by one of the party, the whole of this subject of documents or writings can also be marked as your exhibit or document. So remember that whatever documents presented to the witness, you can also use it as your common exhibit or documentary documents. Okay, so as I've said that direct examination, because there is already a judicial benefit rule, then the judicial benefit rule will be the direct examination. But remember, before the witness will be cross-examined, the lawyer must raise his objection. Why? If he will not raise his objection, then it is deemed waived. Deemed waived. Remember that, future compañeros and compañeras, deemed waived. So you must raise your objection, especially under the rules 2019 rules on civil procedure. How about criminal cases? Eh, yes! It is applicable both civil and criminal cases. So, after cross-examination, as I have said, that a cross-examiner is given a very, very wide latitude. If you raise your objection, Your Honor, the question was not asked during the direct examination. I always objection overruled. Don't you know, Panyero, that a cross-examiner is given a very, very wide latitude? As long as the question asked, even outside the direct examination, is relevant material, not foreign to the issue. I always conducted a lecture to the lawyers. I told them, compañeros, compañeras, I am a student of remedial law. I lectured remedial law to the judges, being a professor, lecturer of the Supreme Court. We call it Philippine Judicial Academy. I lecture judges and justices. I'm also a lecturer of remedial law of Integrated Bar of the Philippines and the DOJ. I lectured all prosecutors, all lawyers around the Philippines. I lectured remedial law. I teach them how to conduct their examination, cross-examination, how to present evidence. I'm also a bar reviewer. I'm a professor of law. So, I always lectured to the lawyers. And I told them that if you are not satisfied with my decision, appeal it to the higher court. But the higher court always sustained my decision. Okay, so what are the extent in a redirect examination? Because cross-examination, the cross-examiner is given wide latitude. How about in redirect examination? Can you ask question in redirect examination even outside the scope of the cross-examination? The answer is no. So, what are really the purpose of redirect examination and what is the extent? After the cross-examination of the witness has been concluded, he may be re-examined by the party calling him to explain or supplement his answer given during the cross-examination. On redirect examination, questions on matters that dealt with during the... So, kapag outside the scope of the cross-examination, you are not allowed to ask questions. Unlike sa cross-examination. But there is only one exception to the rule. As a general rule, you are not allowed to ask questions beyond the scope of the cross-examination. Except the judge will allow you at the discretion of the judge. You know, I always refuse that the lawyer will ask questions beyond the scope of the direct of the cross-examination, except in the interest of justice. In the interest of justice, Your Honor, please allow us, please allow me to ask questions beyond the scope of the cross-examination. Yes, sometimes I granted. Okay, in the interest of justice, I will allow you. But limit your questions to 2 or 3 questions. I will no longer allow you for more than that. Thank you, Your Honor. Thank you, thank you. Okay, how about recross examination? Can you conduct a cross examination, recross examination, beyond the scope of the regular examination? The answer is no. You are not allowed to ask questions beyond or outside the scope of whatever question asked during the regular examination. So, upon the conclusion of the redirect examination, the adverse party may recross examine the witness on matters stated. Remember, companions, and matters stated in the redirect examination. Outside that, that is not allowed. But there is only one exception to the rule. If the judge allow it in the interest of justice. So remember, compañeros, compañeras, direct examination, the purpose. Redirect examination, the purpose. Cross-examination, the purpose. And recross examination, the purpose and the extent. How about the witness was already conducted this direct examination, cross-examination, redirect examination, recross examination. Can the lawyer said, Your Honor, before I will call on my second witness, can I recall my first witness, Mr. Juan de la Cruz? Then I will ask him, on what ground, Panyero? On the ground that, Your Honor, that a very important matters, I was not able to ask questions. Can you allow, Your Honor, to recall my witness for additional direct examination? Can the judge grant it? It depends. So if the lawyer asks the court that he will be allowed to recall his witness, although all the direct examination, cross examination, redirect examination, request already conducted, can he be recalled? It depends upon the discretion of the judge. I always ask, okay, opposing counsel, do you have any objection? I will object, Your Honor. I will object because so if there is an objection, then I will not allow to recall the witness so that there will be an additional direct examination. But if the parties, it's okay to me, Your Honor, then if the opposing party will not object, then I will allow the witness to be recalled. And, okay, Panyero, you can conduct an additional direct examination. Can the opposing counsel conduct an additional cross-examination because there was an additional direct examination? The answer is yes. Okay, Panyero, because of the additional direct examination, then I will allow you to conduct an additional direct examination. How about additional redirect examination? It is allowed? Yes. And recross? Yes. But on my case, di na ako mag-allow mag-conduct na ng redirect examination. Up to cross. Because I always inform them, we are only wasting our time here. Compañeros and compañeras. Okay. Can an adverse party impeach? Can you impeach an adverse party witness? Section 15 of the rules on evidence says that a witness may be impeached by a party against whom he was called by contradictory evidence, by evidence that his general reputation for truth, honesty, or integrity is bad, or by evidence that he made at a particular statement, inconsistent. So, yes, even adverse party witness can be impeached. You can impeach an adverse party witness because he testified in a contradictory evidence. The evidence of his reputation is bad, and that the evidence is inconsistent with the other evidence he presented during the other examination. So, remember that, compañeros and compañeras, that you can impeach your own witnesses. How about exclusion of witnesses? For instance, the prosecution will present 5 witnesses. Can the defense lawyer or the defendant's lawyer ask the court to exclude other witnesses? The answer is yes. What is the purpose? Why other witnesses should be excluded by the judge? In order that they will not hear the testimony of their co-witnesses, so that they cannot coach each other, so that they cannot rectify whatever mistake or wrong testified by their co-witnesses. So the judge will say, there are other witnesses for the prosecution in this case? Yes, Your Honor, 4. Okay, you 4, go to the office of my staff. You are not allowed to witness and to hear the testimony of other witnesses. Yes, that is fair play. So the court, if there are so many witnesses, one by one witnesses will testify. No, that is why I'm very, very strict in conducting trials. I know there are so many students of mine that always witness and observe my trial. And there are so many televisions there because, you know, every time that I conducted hearings, there are so many televisions now around the world. No? And they always, parang pelikula, kumikislap, no? Kumikislap. Because I conducted so many high-profile cases, no? In my court. No? Can the lawyer give protection to the witness? And what are the protections of the witnesses? So, under Section 19 of the Rules on Evidence, what are the rights of the witnesses? It is the right of a witness to be protected from, number one, irrelevant questions, improper questions, insulting questions, or harsh or insulting demeanor, or to detain only as to the interest of justice that requires, or to be examined only to material matters. So, under the our constitution, because I'm also a student of political law, I lecture in political law, bar review, that under our constitution, the witnesses are also protected, also under the rules of court. So what are the protection of the witnesses? They are protected from irrelevant, improper questions, or insulting questions, or harsh or insulting demeanor. I will give you an example. A lawyer testified. Then, the one who conducted the examination said, "Are you really a lawyer?" "Yes." "How many times you took the bar examination?" "I believe that you are not a lawyer. Can you do that?" "No. Lawyers should, judges should protect the every witness from irrelevant, improper, insulting, harsh questions or demeanor. And there are other witnesses, the lawyers will say, bobo." So, yes, the judge should protect each and every witnesses from irrelevant questions, improper questions, insulting questions, harsh or insulting demeanor, like todas ka paglabas mo. So remember that, future compañeros and compañeras. Now, we proceed with very important matters in the rules on evidence. Authentication and proof of documents. There are two kinds of documents: public and private documents. So, what are the public documents and what are the private documents? How you can prove the execution and the authenticity of a public document from the private document? But I will concentrate on a private writing. Before any private writing may be received in evidence, its due execution and authenticity must be proved, number one, by anyone who saw the writing executed. Second, by evidence of the genuineness of the handwriting of the maker. And the third one, by the subscribing witnesses. So these are the only three. Now, we'll not yet discuss the rule on secondary evidence, the rule on parole evidence. We'll first discuss a private writing, its execution and authenticity, how it is proved. So, number one, anyone who saw the writing executed. Second, by the evidence of genuineness of the handwriting of the maker. The third one, by the subscribing witness or witnesses. Where a private writing is more than 30 years, how about, for instance, my book is more than 30 years. If it is more than 30 years, is the evidence of execution necessary? Or is asked in the bar? If it will ask in the bar, is it necessary? And why? Ganun kasi sa bar eh. Is it necessary? And why? When the private document is more than 30 years old, is produced from the custody, it found to be genuine, unblemished by any alteration or circumstances of suspension, no other evidence of its execution of this may be given. No need, no? We call it ancient documents, no? So, if it is more than 30 years, it is called an ancient document. This always asked in the bar examination. How a handwriting be proved? The handwriting of a person may be proved by any witness who believes to be the handwriting of such person and has been the person's writing or seen the writing purportedly or acted upon. The evidence respecting the handwriting may be given in comparison. Pwede na sa comparison. But if it is a question document, it is the National Bureau of Investigation, because in the National Bureau of Investigation, there is what they call a question document expert. Also with the PNP. But I always look on the NBI. Because I have so many students and classmates who work in the NBI. And that, they are the one who will authenticate whether or not the handwriting is genuine or not. We call it question document in the National Bureau of Investigation. So, how about if the document is already notarized? What will become that document? The document becomes a public document. Okay, I really wanted to proceed with my lectures, but it is more than 2 hours now. I will just discuss first pre-trial. No? Remember, compañeros, compañeras, no? Pre-trial. Pre-trial now, and the rule. In civil cases, rule 18, no? Also there is pre-trial in the rules on criminal procedure. Pre-trial, remember this, future compañeros, compañeras, and also lawyers, judge, lawyers and prosecutors who attended my lectures, no? I saw them. That pre-trial is mandatory, both civil and criminal. Pre-trial is mandatory, no? after the filing of the last pleading, the court will set the case for pre-trial. Pre-trial, what are the following concept on pre-trial? Possibility of an applicable settlement or submission of an alternative dispute resolution. So, every time that I conducted a pre-trial, I said, is there a possibility that parties will enter into a compromise agreement? Because it is not mandatory to have an alternative dispute resolution and judicial dispute resolution. Then I always ask the parties, we'll now simplify the issues. Because the complainants have 20 issues, the defendants have 30 issues. I said, no, we will simplify the issues. Can you imagine that? Whether or not the complainant is entitled to moral damages, actual damages, exemplary damages, nominal damages. Same with the respondents, whether or not the respondents is entitled to actual damages, nominal damages, exemplary damages, moral damages. I said, we'll just simplify, compañeros, compañeras. Whether or not the complainants and the respondents are entitled for actual damages, moral damages, nominal damages, exemplary damages, attorney's fees, litigation expenses, and cost of the suit. Why there are so many? We just simplify it. We just simplify it. So there must be simplification of the issues. Then there will be marking exhibits before the trial report. No? Then failure to appear in the pretrial, then if you are the complainant, non-suited, if you are the defendant, in default. Okay, future compañeros, compañeras, my students in the College of Law, the bar examinees are taking the bar examination, and lawyers and judges. I saw judges here also, and prosecutors who watch my lectures. Thank you very much, and we have no more time. God bless. I will lecture again next time. No? God bless you all. Good luck for the bar examination. And that I will lecture the first subject in the bar, political law and international law. I will conduct a forecast. No kidding, no bragging. Last year, last bar examination, my forecast in political law and international law is 85%. 85%. One of my students topped the bar. So I'll be the one to lecture on first subject in the bar, political law and international law. Marami ng mga schools tumawag sa akin. Judge, can you help us in the bar review in political law and international law? Yes, I'm very, very willing. And that I will invite you all. No? Marami nang tumawag sa akin na mag-conduct ng first bar review lectures and first forecast. No? Kung ano ang lalabas ng bar examination. Okay, good luck and God bless you all. Bye-bye. Good night.